St. Lucia, this is Open Mic, and we're now back to the fourth and final segment of our program. When we left off, we were in discussion with Mr. Mayers in respect to what is going on with the, as a result of the impacts and the decision being taken by foreign nationals against our country. Okay.
Yeah. So what are you said? You
The Prime Minister has thrown out on more than one occasions a remark stating that you were the national security before, and you what did you do about it when you were there, as far as the whole makeup of the security system of St. Lucia was concerned?
No, I was the Minister for National Security, yeah. But I was not the Attorney General. Yeah. There was the Minister for Justice,
okay.
and Attorney General who dealt with the judiciary.
Got you.
The judiciary didn't fall under my responsibility at all.
Okay.
The police, immigration, and those issues, home affairs, citizenship fell under my portfolio, okay. But not the judiciary.
Yeah. And you never interfered with what was going on. It was truly a separation of powers then.
And exactly. And we had the police. And I've always said the police have the commissioner of police is an independent authority.
Yes.
And he should be treated with respect. Yeah. And any of the police officers, commissioners that I've worked with, they can tell you that we had a professional relationship.
Got you.
It was not my responsibility to dictate to them what to do. I've always maintained that the police is separate to the minister, and that if a minister fell out of line, he could be arrested.
Yeah.
So it cannot be that I am going to dictate to the police commissioner what to do. Police operations are police operations. Operations are dictated or managed by the police, not the minister.
That's right. Remember,
not the ministry.
Yeah, remember what happened to at Watergate. Eh?
Exactly.
Yeah,
so the police are independent, and the police needs to be assisted. The ministry assists with policy formulation. The ministry ensures that the police get the resources that they need to do their work.
Right.
But when it comes to police operations, it's a totally different ballgame. That is not the purview or responsibility of the minister. It is a responsibility of the commissioner of police and his men and women of the police force. And this is how I ran my ministry.
Right. Now, you were talking before also about, you see, there's also strong rumors going on in connection with that impacts report, and they feel that the Prime Minister had too much to do with it, and he has a lot of questions to answer. And it is again very worrying because we know for a fact that the European Union, the Americans, and the Canadians are looking at St. Lucia very clearly now. And you know, that's really awful for us at this stage of our lives to be going through what we're going through. What I asked you before we left here, what is the prognosis on the whole thing? You were in the, I mean, you know how these foreigners deal with us and so on. What you can see the next line of action against St. Lucia? What is likely to happen?
St. Lucia is now between a rock and a hard place because from day one, my contention is that the Prime Minister handled the impacts situation badly, in a very irresponsible manner. And I've said before that the Labour Party have to take responsibility for what has transpired. When you dig a hole, you fall. When you dig a pit, you will end up falling in that pit. Right? And so they have to clean up the mess. But instead of the Prime Minister allowing the mess to be cleaned up by the judicial system, what has he done?
Yeah.
I mean, it was crazy when I heard the Minister for National Security in trying to explain why the Minister for Housing had made the comments he made about the DPP, saying on to the nation that, oh, you know the way those reports are, they're sensitive, and that is why the report or the evidence could not have been given to the DPP with the report. And when I heard that, I said, but what ridiculous comment is this? Whenever there are investigations, it is the DPP's office that decides where to move, what's the next stage to take with the investigation, whether there is enough evidence to take anybody to court, or whether you go to a coroner's inquest or whatever. The treatment is decided upon based on the evidence that is provided by the police to the DPP.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So when you're telling me you'll give the DPP the report,
mm-hmm.
but the information, the evidence is so sensitive you cannot give it to the DPP, then how in the world is the DPP supposed to mm-hmm. proceed mm-hmm. with any action
yeah.
in the absence of having, and she herself said
mm-hmm.
that what she got was not in conformity to the laws of St. Lucia,
mm-hmm.
and she did not have evidence, so how in the world can she go
for
forward?
Sure, yeah.
So the government has bungled this whole thing,
mm-hmm.
and they are to blame for it.
Mm-hmm.
They can't blame anybody else for it. So how then are they now going to appease the Americans
mm-hmm.
by doing what the Americans are requiring them to do
mm-hmm.
when they have messed up
mm-hmm.
the whole report?
To Rick Wayne Shaw. The past this week and the week before, and I heard him talking about certain lawyers in Washington
yes.
who've been appointed,
yes.
and I'm told that the Washington lawyers have indicated that there's nothing they can really do. It's a matter that the Prime Minister was told what he has to do. He just has to move ahead with that, and nothing will happen.
Well, we asked the United Workers Party had put out a press statement
uh-huh.
asking questions of
yeah.
the Prime Minister,
mm.
and I was pleased that he was forced to go on. I heard him on an interview on HTS,
mm.
explaining mm. what had happened, explaining that $150,000 had to be paid. He signed that contract since in December.
Mm.
He indicated that. Tax, we don't have to worry because taxpayers
mm.
are not going to pay for it.
Yeah.
Now, come on.
Yeah.
And then you have one set of lawyers being paid he said
mm.
that these people are the ones who are, I think, running the CIP program.
Yeah. Mm.
And so they are concerned about the image of St. Lucia
mm.
because it's a product. St. Lucia is a product they now have to sell.
Mm-hmm.
So that is why they are paying the $150,000
mm.
to another set of lawyers who are supposed to be lobbying on behalf of St. Lucia. Now, how is that going to assist St. Lucia? It's another round of action that is not going to bring the desired results.
It's a round of futility. Yeah.
And so St. Lucia, the police are still going to be in a position where the Americans are not going to give assistance to them.
Mm-hmm.
The Americans are not going to allow them to travel, some of them to travel to the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
And so the whole game
mm-hmm.
continues because the Prime Minister continues to handle this thing
mm-hmm.
in a very irresponsible
way. In other words, he has to face the reality of the situation.
Exactly.
He's not. Yeah.
And come out and say I'm wrong. I've made an out.
Yeah.
Let me correct it.
Yeah.
But now he wants to put the blame on me.
Yeah.
All of a sudden,
mm-hmm.
he needs to deal with the matter
mm-hmm.
or shut up.
Mm-hmm. But tell me something, Guy. When you were with the government, I mean, you don't have to answer that question. But what kind of monies in value were the Americans giving to our security people? How much? What are we talking in dollars?
Well,
was it substantial?
For sure, the Marine Police,
mm-hmm.
The last two fast boats that they got.
Yeah.
Was part of
the package.
The Americans' security package for the region.
Yeah, that's expensive.
And these boats are very expensive.
Yeah, right.
One of these boats cost more than $500,000.
Right. And we're talking US dollars.
And, right, US dollars. Yeah. And they were given two of them.
Mm.
And they do a lot of training.
Mm.
There are other military wear that they donate
mm-hmm.
To the St. Lucia. And also, some of the ammunition and so on that we have to purchase,
yeah.
you must get the license
okay.
through them.
So they actually give goods, so they don't give cash per se, they really just give...
No, they hardly give
okay.
they hardly give
any
cash, but they facilitate
yes.
a lot of the training,
yeah.
etc.
Which is expensive. Yeah.
Very expensive.
And that is how long that has been withdrawn now? How many years?
It's 2 years already.
Wow.
So you could imagine the impact
it's having on the police and security wise. Yeah.
Exactly.
Mm. But
so it's really time that this thing is brought
mm.
to an end,
mm.
and the Prime Minister needs to do the right thing.
Now the question has been posed both by the Prime Minister and various people in St. Lucia, assuming that the Prime Minister goes to the polls. And the United Workers Party are in power. Based on what you know today, what kind of action can you see your government taking?
But we have made, we have said what we're going to do, that within the first 100 days of us assuming power, we are going to put, we're going to inquire into this whole impact. So we're going to get a foreign judicial person to deal with that matter and to deal with it expeditiously.
Okay.
Because we need to bring this
to
an end as soon as possible. It cannot be allowed. The Prime Minister cannot continue to play political football with this matter and think that people are fools.
You know, I was just talking to a friend who who's a judge in Canada. I forgot the guy's name, but he's from the Denry area. He's a high judge in
Judge
Canada.
Regis,
correct. And he is actually quite friendly with the Prime Minister.
Mm-hmm.
And he offered the services, his services and a couple other judges in Canada, and Canada would pay for it, to come here and deal with all these cases, because they did it in Jamaica and it worked. And I understand the Prime Minister said, well, I would like to employ you. He said, look, I don't want a job, I have a job. I'm just telling you what we would like to do.
And he's a very well-respected judge in Canada.
Yeah.
After the last time I was in up in Canada, I met with him, and we have
Mr. Regis. His name is Regis.
Mr. Regis.
Okay.
I know he means well, and he loves his country.
Yeah.
And he's prepared to assist his country.
Yeah.
And so the Europeans have also said that they will make the resources, the
available.
Financial resources available to
European
deal with it.
They said they had 44,000 euros or something like that.
And so it begs the question, what is happening?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's really sad. But, I just can't understand that this matter has been allowed to drag to that extent.
I mean, I hear the Prime to talk about, and the Minister talks about, those things happened under my watch.
Mm.
But police killings have happened under the watch of the current Prime Minister.
Yeah.
Since they've been in power, there have been police killings happening under them. But is the United Workers' Party going to go and make reports on our government to foreign governments to try to make our country look bad just to score political points? No, we're not going to do that.
Yeah.
And that is a big difference between what pertains under their watch and what pertains now.
Yeah.
Right, because we respect our country, and we will not do just anything just for political power.
Expediency.
And that is why I said the Labour Party has to bear responsibility for what has happened.
Yeah,
and they need to clean up the mess that they created.
I heard Herman Gil Francis speaking openly about it,
exactly.
And he was apparently Commissioner of Police, and he said these things that happen from time to time.
These things happened before our watch. Yeah. Under the previous reign of the Prime Minister, there were police killings. Since they have been in power the last 4.5 years, there have been police killings.
Mm-hmm.
Look at the one in Souffre.
Yeah.
That caused so much uproar.
Correct.
So if you were talking about doing an investigation, why was it only those
that under the
why is it that those that had happened in 2012 they were not included in there, and what happened to those from 2011 November when we left to now? Why, what is, what's on? But we are not going to make an issue out of that because we recognize that sometimes under with police operations these things happen. Every life is important. Nobody's saying nobody's downplaying that, but when you play politics with the whole issue of your national security, then you have a problem.
You know, Guy, we're now coming to the end of our program, but something again I've been saying to St. Lucia time and time again, we have so many St. Lucians here out of work, and everybody says there's a certain percentage that are not employable. You know, really and truly, I mean, you were in the Ministry of Commerce at one time, and you were in the corridors of government. Am I talking out of turn when I say that really and truly they should have two or three vocational schools in St. Lucia, and they have professors in France and England who are willing to come and make their services available for free to do those things?
But you see, the Labour Party likes to brag about them being the one who implemented universal secondary education.
Yeah.
But there are flaws with that, because you're treating one size does not fit all.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been a strong proponent of tech voc education.
Mm.
That is why when I was the president of the Chamber of Commerce, one of the programs I implemented was the Junior Achievement Program, because I recognized that not all the kids are academically inclined.
Correct, yeah.
And they need, if you don't teach them about business,
yes,
how are they going to know how to start a business?
Correct.
On leaving school?
Yeah.
And I'm strong on entrepreneurial development,
yeah,
because that's, I'm an entrepreneur, yeah, as well.
The Jamaica, right. The Junior Chamber of Commerce.
Yeah. And so I felt that even while you look at universal secondary education, a couple of the schools should be turned into technical vocational schools.
Yeah.
We should have a strong technical vocational program in place for those kids who may find that academics are a little too much for them.
When I was at college, right. Brother Candice started out at the college, you know. Yeah, he saw
the
that
comprehensive
then.
School was one of those that had a very strong
technical
component.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All of that has gone.
Gone, yeah.
And I'm saying some of those schools do not have a lot of students,
mm-hmm.
or like the Marigold School that has now been named after John Odlum and so on. Some of those schools, in my opinion, should be turned into technical colleges.
Yes.
We can get some of those professors
from the
U.S.
wherever.
And England, wherever, come down. Yeah. They can take turns at coming down and implementing appropriate programs. We need well-trained carpenters, we need other technical people. Yeah. And I would say that what NSDF is doing, it's not enough.
Yeah.
You cannot turn someone, especially from that has not worked for however, does not even
all
have
sudden,
two GCs. Mm. You take them for 2 months or 3 months and you expect them to be a professional plumber, a professional electrician in 2 months.
There's no grounding.
There's no grounding.
Correct,
and so we need to have a proper technical vocational
and the same
program
way you have
place.
Children of 4 and 5 now who can operate their tablets.
The
same way if you stand by the child that he grows up and you know you don't have to be a full-fledged
that is a weakness with the universal secondary education.
Yeah.
Because you have kids who only got maybe 10% in their exams and they're sitting with students who got 70 and 60. How are they going to cope?
Yeah.
So most of those children are better in a technical vocational program than trying to do the academic subjects.
St. Lucia, this is Open Mic. We've just come to the end of the fourth segment of our program, and I want to thank you so much for listening. I hope our show today was informative, as usual, and we'll be happy to talk to you again next time. This is Open Mic, say good night.